to you, Varad.
हेलो,
Yes, Varad, you are audible.
थैंक यू सो मच पूजा एंड थैंक्स अ लॉट प्रतिभा सर फॉर डूइंग ए वेरी वेल एंड वेरी वेल मैनर्ड सेशन. सो आई विल नाउ इंट्रोड्यूस अबाउट रोटेरियन श्याम अर्जुन वाडकर, विच इज ए पास्ट प्रेसिडेंट. मिस्टर अर्जुन वाडकर इज एन एंटरप्रेन्योर, फाउंड्री मैन विथ एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ 40 ईयर्स इन द फील्ड एंड सीईओ फाउंड्री जियोमेट्रिक्स, कंसल्टेंट फॉर द फाउंड्री प्रोजेक्ट्स, चेयरमैन ऑफ द सेंटर ऑफ एक्सेलेंस ऑफ IIF, नेशनल सेंटर फॉर टेक्निकल सर्विसेज, मेंबर एडिटोरियल बोर्ड इंडियन फाउंड्री जर्नल, ऑनर फेलो ऑफ IIF, हैज प्रेजेंटेड सेवरल टेक्निकल पेपर्स एट वेरियस नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल फोरम्स इंक्लूडिंग वर्ल्ड फाउंड्री कांग्रेस एंड पब्लिश एट वेरियस जर्नल्स. हिज पेपर एट WFC इज अवॉर्डेड एज बेस्ट पेपर ऑफ द कांग्रेस. हार्टिएस्ट कॉन्ग्रेचुलेशंस टू यू सर. ही इज अ मेंबर ऑफ सेवन एप्सिलॉन इंटरनेशनल कंसोर्टियम्स, ए लेटेस्ट कंसेप्ट इन क्वालिटी मैनेजमेंट, रिप्रेजेंटेड इंडिया फॉर BRIC's फाउंड्री फोरम एट जोहानिसबर्ग, साउथ अफ्रीका एंड हैज प्रेजेंटेड ए टेक्निकल पेपर एट मेटल कास्टिंग कांग्रेस ऑफ साउथ अफ्रीका. ही वॉज इन्वाइटेड बाय द AFS न्यूयॉर्क चैप्टर टू स्पीक एट देयर फोरम. ऑफिशियल इंडियन डेलीगेंट्स फॉर वर्ल्ड फाउंड्री कांग्रेस ओसाका जापान. ए वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट डेवलपमेंट इज दैट ही इज वेरी रिसेंटली अपॉइंटेड एज ए चेयरमैन बोर्ड ऑफ गवर्नर्स फॉर नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ फाउंड्री एंड फॉर्ज टेक्नोलॉजी बाय MHRD, गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया. रोटेरियन श्याम अर्जुन वाडकर इज ऑल्सो एसोसिएटेड विथ वेरियस सोशल एंड एकेडमिक इंस्टीट्यूट. ही इज पास्ट प्रेसिडेंट रोटरी क्लब ऑफ पुणे शिवाजीनगर. आई कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट यू एंड इन्वाइट यू फॉर द रेस्ट ऑफ द स्पीक्स. ओवर टू यू पूजा.
Thanks, Varad, for the introduction. Over to you, Shyam sir. Like, you can proceed with the session.
Oh well, thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Adik and Puja. It is really delightful experience for me to be with the young people. I always like to be with the Rotaractors because that gives me the energy for the more performance. So thanks a lot for this opportunity. I will start with my presentation. Well, I hope you all are able to see the presentation or the PPT, whatever I have been made.
Yes, sir.
I hope you have listened to me. You can see the presentations. Well, gentlemen,
Yes, sir, it
the
is.
Program is organized by my friend, Mr. Pradeep Bhak, a committed person, devoted person for the enterprise education, and also a philanthropic. So let me start with the presentation with what I feel. I mean, okay. Yeah, so as I said, I'm with my friend Mr. Pradeep. So let me let me start with the quote that what is the goal of a life. So to my opinion, the definition is very simple. It's a manifestation of life, is the exploring of one's God-given and self-developed abilities for benefit of society, including thyself, joyfully. The word joyfully is important here, because you care for everybody, but sometimes, especially the entrepreneur, they don't care for themselves. So as an entrepreneurship, entrepreneurship is a manifestation of your potential. That is what I can make the definition in one sentence. Now, what are the other virtues of entrepreneurship? You can read in the presentation slide, enjoy the creativity, because we always bubbling. I mean, especially the youth, they're bubbling with the creative attitudes and they enjoy to be creative. Then self-contentment, the kind of satisfaction you get out of that is amazing. And generate wealth for self and nation. Just now, Mr. Pradeep has said that our GDP has fallen and we have to recoup ourselves to enhance the GDP, because unless and until you generate the wealth, you cannot sustain the growth of your nation, of your individual too. So naturally, this is one of the virtue why you have to be an entrepreneur. So that same thing what we have said about this, there was a national GDP growth, and this is the opportunity for the dignified self-employment. As I just now you heard Mr. Krishnan sir, that what all the lawyers and doctors and other professionals, they are also included in that. They are self-employment, and that is a dignified self-employment, I can say. So that is a satisfaction what you give. And the productivity and invention to accelerate the growth. So this gives you the opportunity, immense opportunity to inventions and to accelerate the growth. So having said this, to my opinion, I'm just pondering a couple of thoughts with you, my thoughts with you. What I feel about the entrepreneurship and about the enterprising things and all. Judgment, I can say there are four kinds of entrepreneurs. One is a technocrat entrepreneur, other is an investor entrepreneur, third was a businessman entrepreneur, and fourth is an entrepreneur, inventor and entrepreneur. Let me give you four very popular examples. The real technocrat entrepreneur is, to my opinion, is the largest of them all. The picture on the big canvas is of Bill Gates. You go to Google and you can find so many hundreds of pictures of Mr. Bill Gates. I selected this particular picture because it has a very important quote of the kind of message what right now Mr. Krishnan sir has also tried to deliver you, that don't compare yourself with anyone in the world. If you do so, you are insulting yourself. That's the quote in this photograph. So I preferred this photograph for the Bill Gates. Look at him. He's a technocrat entrepreneur. He had an idea. He has some ideas. He was studying. He loved the studies. He toyed his idea passionately and then come out with the programs and which has changed the world of computers. And this is what the technocrat entrepreneur. Then we can go to the one thing I can say, if you attended the earlier webinars, you can say that Mr. Bill Gates has left the education and done this. And my friend, Mr. Nitin Naik, he has completed his graduation in engineering and done it and started his enterprise with Cubex. So you can have your own choice. Depending on your passion and depending on your confidence, you can have your choice. And now with the new education system, you can take a gap and you can again rejoin. Your credits are always be there available with you to rejoin the things. The next we are classification is investor entrepreneur. To him, the Warren Buffett, very popular person. He's an investor. World knows him as a great investor. So he is not bothered what kind of enterprise he's going to have, whether it is a technical, whether it is a software, or whether it is a chemical or a textile. He's no way concerned with that. He is concerned with the things, what kind of profits or returns I'm going to get out of my investment. And that helps. And that he keeps his investment growing. And that is the enterprising thing what he is doing with this. So it's the second kind of entrepreneur, that is an investor entrepreneur. Or we'll go to the third kind, and that is a businessman entrepreneur. You all know Mukesh Ambani. Mukesh Ambani is a second generation entrepreneur. The base is ready by made and prepared by Mr. Dhirubhai Ambani, and it was very strong base. So naturally, the question comes: what Mr. Mukesh should think of it? But having, you can say, a very very matured businessman, inculcated the heritage, the business culture from the family background, he thinks of developing the business. And the difference between the investor, entrepreneur, and the businessman is that businessman thinks of what kind of business he should be in. He takes care of all the aspects. What Mr. Right now you are hearing from Mr. Bhatt, that what should be the marketing strategy, what should be the finance strategy, what should be the product I should get involved into that, whether it is selling vegetables or making the petroleum chemicals or making the textiles or having the 4G network for you. So he thinks of it. He thinks of the enterprises. He thinks of the technology. He thinks of the finances. He thinks of the entire gamut of the business, entire gamut of the entrepreneurship, and then takes the decision, raises the money. It's not that all the money is available in his pocket. He raises the money. He has established his credentials, that his investors and his members of his company, they believe in him, they trust in him, and he makes the proper use of it and gives the returns to them. So this is also enterprising, and this is a businessman enterprise. Having said about this third, the last one, the fourth one is very important, that is the inventor entrepreneur. And who is the best inventor entrepreneur? To my knowledge, Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison, if you visit US in New Jersey, Thomas Edison's lab is there. Please visit. I decided to spend a couple of hours there. I spent a day over there. What you can see? You can see right from the horn of a Reno to the exotic chemicals. Anything you think of it, and that thing is available in that lab. And he has touched every avenue, every concern of material and the science, right from gramophone to light and recording and whatnot. I mean, everything, you name the technology, and Edison is there somewhere. He's the pioneer and the founder of the science and technology what we are enjoying as on date. And what was, why I say him an entrepreneur, invented entrepreneur, and not only the inventor, because his I interacted with few of the people, and I could able to see one gentleman there, very old, and he could share his thoughts about Edison with me. And what I gathered is that Mr. Edison, when he will have the idea of some new invention, he has got a very good team. He has built up a very close-knit team of all sorts of genius people around him. He will discuss that idea with his team, and they will start working on that very logically. And as Mr. Edison sees that they are very close to realization, then he will start approaching the investors and the real users of that particular invention, potential users, what he has thought of, or whom he is making that invention, or what could be the market of it. He will start approaching them, and then ultimately in turn he will get the investors for his idea after realization what he will do that. So as an entrepreneur, he will see that how he generate the money out of it, and that's the thing why I called him as an invented entrepreneur. And do you know how many he holds? 1093 US patents, and there are so many ideas which are not patented, and that's the way. So this is the fourth kind of entrepreneur what I can say. So after saying this, rather defining these four kind of entrepreneurs, I would like to bring your attention to one fact, that what are the common factors of all of them, and what are the virtues, or what not the virtues, but what are the qualities, or what are the specific qualities what entrepreneur has to inculcate in him before he decides to get in the to be an entrepreneur. You can see the common factor in all the four is that they accepted the responsibility of the enterprise, whatever the way, with the planning what Mr. Krishnan sir has told, with the methodical working what Mr. Pradeep sir has said, or by the way, with the ways what my friend Mr. Nitin Naik has said to you in earlier session. They accepted the total responsibility of our enterprise of all the decisions whatever they are making. And then the next very important thing is that they kept it growing, because believe me, my friends, in nature, either there is a growth or there is a decay. There is not a complacence in the nature. You can't see that the tree is there at some height and it is complacent there, and he said that I'm not going to grow. The moment you think that this is enough for me, believe me, you are digging yourself. So you have to see that your enterprise, you keep growing. And the last one is that fulfilling aspirations of a team. And that's what, right from what the people we have talked about, from Bill Gates to Mr. Buffett, then to your Mukesh Ambani or our Edison. The team, you know, the team has got the different requirements. Every year, suppose whatever their achievements are there, suppose your team, whatever his earnings are there, he needs something more next year. He needs some more facilities, some more money. And then in that case, you have to see that your team is happy. Their aspirations are fulfilled. So you have to keep yourself growing. And if you keep yourself growing, then only you can fulfill the aspirations of a team. So they can concentrate on their assigned work and they deliver the best of the results to you. So these are the common factors what you have seen. So if you want to be an entrepreneur, if you want to be there, if you want to be a successful entrepreneur, you have to see that you promise, you vow for all these things, commit for all these things, and decide on the thing. Okay. Now everybody, every entrepreneur, the quality of every entrepreneur, one of the important thing is that he likes to share his story. And this opportunity is given to me. I'm really happy with that. You know, my story, I will begin with my birth. The very reason why I said it that, because I am born in Kirloskarwadi. Kirloskarwadi is a colony of Kirloskar Brothers Limited, the engineering company, which is founded by late Lakshmanrao Kirloskar, the doyen of our engineering industries in India. And the dispensary or the hospital where I was born, it just across the gate of that factory. So when I had my first breath, there was a crisp smell of a furnace fumes coming out of that factory. The first humming sound what I heard by my ears, a newborn, is of the humming of the machines. And the atmosphere, as you grow up, what you see? You see nothing but the factory. All ambience is tuned to that. So naturally, right from that day, right from that moment, the moment is 25th July 1950, and maybe in morning. So that's the moment I born, and this thought of entrepreneurship has been inculcated me by the ambience and by the surroundings and the environments where I was born in. So this is the way I thought. And then sometimes there is a debate that entrepreneurship, from which age it should be taught or from which age it should be inculcated in the minds of the students or the youth. And now this is my story. There is no limit. There is no limit. As you start understanding the world, you start understanding, because entrepreneurship is a part and parcel of this world. So as you start understanding the world, you start understanding the entrepreneurship. So in my childhood, as I see, you know, I told you about this environments. It was a foundry. It was a cast metal things. The components of the cast metal. Cast metal, casting components, you can say, right from the car engines to non-ferrous components, right from aeroplanes to car engines to textiles to machine tools, wherever the applications are there, there are there. Rather, in fact, we say the casting business has grown up with the mankind progress. Because you see, earlier you say that there is a low age, there is an iron age and a copper age and aluminum age and whatnot. So the earlier the growth of mankind, the humanity is related to the casting. So we take that pride that we are the people who have served the humanity from the beginning of the humanity. So this is what I felt. And then incidentally, I completed my education. I became graduate, and then my goal was fixed, because right from my school days, I decided I used to make the sketches. What should be my factory? I'm talking about the engineering industry. My friend Nitin has talked to you last time about the software industry, but that's a new generation of the enterprise. And I'm from a little bit old generation, but nevertheless, that's a basic generation. That's a basic of the commodities, what we required in our life for the progress. So I'm talking mainly about the engineering industry as such. So I used to plan and think about the foundry, casting, machine shop, the components. In childhood, of course, I was not thinking what product I will be making, but something to deal with the metal casting and the components of it. That's what my idea is fixed. So you will laugh at the things, but initially, at a very early age, I was thinking of making the aeroplanes, but ultimately, I realized that's not my cup of tea. So I was very passionate about what I said, and I started concentrating on that. I got graduation made, and then I started planning how do I start. Unfortunately, I didn't hear this kind of programs in those days, that is the late 70s. And believe me, I missed what Mr. Krishnan has given advice to you, that what entrepreneur has to think of before embarking on the entrepreneurship. Nobody told me that. Though my father was an engineer, but entrepreneurship is a different category altogether. His guidance and blessings are always with me. Even today, though he's not there, I feel his blessings are there with me. But entrepreneurship, to accept the responsibility, keep the things growing, that's the total commitment, and that thing was there. What I was having only the passion, having the idea to start an enterprise and to work with that. And then when I started thinking of it and what is the money available with me, I find out that whatever available, as you can say, the pocket money was available for me, what my parents used to give to me when I was in college, that was maybe around 1,000-1,400 of that time. And then I requested my parents, I discussed loudly my ideas to crystallize on that. Fortunately, my parents and my family was very much encouraging to this idea. We were happy-go-lucky family. We are not rich, but at the same time, we are not all that we were in comfort zone, you can say. So in those days, in the late 70s, my family could spare around 5,000 rupees to me. And then with the 6,500 rupees capital with me, I started, how do I go with that? Because if you think of the foundry, that was my passion. And then you need to have a furnace, you need to have the mold, you need to have the mold boxes, you need to have a raw material, because that's a manufacturing process altogether. That's not a machine shop. Whether you got something, some material is given by somebody, you act upon that and you deliver it to me. It's not that easy. It's a manufacturing. You have to create something out of the cavity. And there's a pride for a foundry man. And then I started searching the opportunity, how do I get? And then I found out there is a place available on the rent, and there is some old furnace. And then I decided to get into that. I picked the deal at the 16,000 rupees. I had a personal loan from the bankers, of course, from the cooperative bank, because for such kind of things, nationalized bank, there was no use. But that's a different story. If I start telling you all the pieces and bits and started explaining all these things, the 15-20 minutes given to me are not enough. I mean, it may take much, much, much longer than that. So I will cut short. I started with this in a rental place. I started making the jobbing foundry, making the casting as required by the customers. In those days, it was very easy to get approached to the big companies. Maybe in those days, if you're familiar with the Pune, you can say the Thermax, Tata Motors, and the big names like Bajaj Auto and all. And it was not all that difficult as on today to have the vendor's code and the registrations made in those days. So with your good networking, you can approach to them and start doing that. So I started doing the business. And the important facet, what I want to tell you in between, is that when I started approaching these corporate companies and started dealing with them, I realized that the language what they speak is different. And then I check what kind of language they speak. And then I understand that that's the management language they speak about it. And then I started inquiring where this language is taught. And then I came to know that that is taught in the management schools. So I decided to join management And then I did my post graduation of the part time in IMDR, and that has helped me a lot. So again, just leave a thought with you, because if you want to manage skillfully your business, if you want to make real good use of the money and the cash flow available with you, you should learn how to manage with that, how to manage your enterprise, how to manage your cash flow, and both these things together that leads to you for the successful interview. Not only these two, there are so many things related to that. So then gradually, both Mr. Krishnan sir and Pradeep has said to you, that start, keep your eyes and ears open and keep gathering the information what is available to you related to your products. I found out that jobbing order, I mean, depending on the customer's requirement, you produce the component and supply to them is not enough, because value addition is limited, your profits are limited, your sustainability is limited, your growth is limited. Then we decided to embark on some product. I mean, I started giving thought that can we get into the product, and we found out that the castings are used where the heat is there, and there are the boilers where the heat is there, and they need the components. I was supplying to Thermax, I was supplying to some other boiler manufacturers. I realized that wherever there is a heat, there is a casting, because they sustain your expansions and all. So the castings are inevitable, their life is good, other qualities and the properties of the material, they're as required for that. So I concentrated on that, and the first product we developed as an import substitute. Fortunately, I'm obliged by my customer, they had given me the opportunity to do that. And why they had given me the opportunity? By looking at my passion to do and develop. Not just because I had presented them any plan for that, in the business plan to that, because I was not sure of my own. But I was passionate that yes, I can do that. My team was passionate about that, so I was able to make that. And we made the first mechanical stoker, which will, why I'm saying this, the mechanical stoker, because you know, the unburned fuel is an issue for the boilers. You waste the calorific value of that fuel. Your energy is not converted fully to your desired use. So we start to put the mechanization to that. So you can make good use of your fuel. You can transfer that. That's the science. And then you make use of it. You have the phenomenon, and then you develop the product. And I'm sure this phenomenon is a very positive phenomenon, because if I say that you are going to save 20% of fuel, by any chance, if my predictions or assumptions are wrong, you may say instead of 15%, but whatever it is, but still you are saving something. So your ROI may be a little bit longer, but it's a very positive phenomenon which appeals to the customer. So I started getting the customers. And one more thing, what I got, the associates. And when I started doing this product, fortunately, I got associated with the company like a Force Marshall, because they were earlier importing this kind of equipments and selling to the Indian markets. And when they saw by somewhere other way, we come together, and then and overnight, in a day one, I got associated with that company. I got in my list 14 offices in India across the country. And that has given me the real breakthrough in my business enterprise. Earlier, I was not having a chair which has got a 4 good legs to sit on. But with the passion, by looking at the product and the results what my product was giving, I could able to tie myself with one of the very good and promising company in Indian Industries Empire. And they believed in me, looking at my passion and the capabilities of me and my team. And then they accepted that they will market for me, and they do that. Incidentally, I will like to share one more thought with that. There are limitations to have that, because after a few years, I realized that my product is one of the product in their basket. I got in their basket, there are 100 products, and my product is 101. So intensity of marketing my product is 100 of their entire marketing team. And for me, that's my bread and butter. So my intensity is 100% to sell that product. So very amicably, we had a very good dialogue. And we also started marketing my own products along with them in a very complementary way, with very good understanding and very and we started getting very good results in that. So ultimately we kept growing this mechanical stopper. Then we then you have to keep the growth, we have to develop, and you have to keep on inventing the new products. As we come close to the border, we found it, as I say, that we are passionate about the energy. We saw that there is a lot of energy going west through the flue gas, and you learn the heat energy contents of a flue gas in your textbooks. That's the heat transfer equations. Your flue gas contains the heat, because that is around 300 degrees centigrade or 400 degrees centigrade. The flue gases, they pass away. The volume is much in tons cubic meters. And then that's kind of heat energy, energy is passing into the atmosphere that hampers to the atmosphere and the environment, and also you are wasting the energy. So we thought of capturing that heat, and we started of designing the economizers, that is the heat transfer equipment. The water is, in the simple words, the water is flowing to the economizer tubes, and all that entire assembly weighing around few tons that escaped in the flue pass of the boiler. So the flue gases pass through that all arrangements, and the heat is transferred from that waste heat is transferred to the water inside. So instead of feeding the water of say ambient temperature to the boiler, you are feeding it to the higher temperature water. So suppose your ambient is 30 degrees centigrade, instead of paying the 30 degrees centigrade, you feed the water of around 80-90 degrees centigrade. So that's the amount of heat you save. That's the basic of the science, and you convert it into a successful business phenomenon. Believe me, with this one simple science phenomenon, I could survive, my company could survive, and my competence could survive, and my workmen, my staff, my team, my marketing team, and the people depending on me, my suppliers, my vendors, all of them, we could survive on that. So one simple phenomenon of a science converted into technology, which has given a good life, I can say, to several. Subsequently, we developed fly ash arresters, and then gradually we changed our identity from a jobbing foundry to the project engineering company. We have the project engineers, we have got all full-fledged, we have got a very, very best of the labs available, calibrated by certified by the Lloyds or international agencies and all. We made the direct exports to the various countries, and then we diverted to one more machine shop having some different product with some state-of-art machine shop over there, that was the SC Private Limited. And then what I am talking to you is about this cast iron, that we also ventured into the steel. We started a new venture which will be prominently for the foundries. We thought of making some product like a copper capillaries for the ball pens and all, what you see. But in those days, it was not difficult. It was very difficult because commodity market, what is regulated as on date, it was not regulated in those days. So it was very difficult unless and until you have, in those days, what you say, the number two money, you can't get into that. And that was not my cup of tea. So we decided to go for the backward integration, and we thought of developing something else. So we done that. In all these years, do you feel that it is easy going? No way. There are lots of problems, ifs and buts. There are so many policies that change. There are so many marketing efforts you need to do. You need to change so many marketing strategies. You need to convince your financiers. You need to convince your people. You need to have various agreements with your workmen. Though I'm a recipient of a best employer relationship award, but in spite of it, you need to cover some protocols, their needs of your business. You need to do that. So every moment, every day gives you the different challenges, and you have to overcome with that. And as these things happen to your business, your surroundings, your environments of your state, of your nation, of your country, they keep on changing. As you see right now today, though you are perfect in your business, your pandemic has hampered your business. You see your total GDP has gone down 25%. 25% is a phenomenal. I mean, it's not a small thing. It's a question of survival. If it goes deep more than 1-2%, we don't know how we are going to survive. How our economy is there. We are just at the threshold at the brink of falling down rather aimlessly. So what you need to look at it, what are the environments, are there any changes in environments? You have to have a foresight, you have to develop your sixth sense when you are in the business. What are our friends like Mukesh Ambani or the Wadiyas, they are the best at it, or maybe the Piramals. So whether you are an MSME or a medium scale or a large scale corporate, you need to have that sense. You have to look at the environments, what your country is doing, where the world is having, what is happening in the world. If somewhere somewhat exposed, you know, I know one case who is my very good customer. He was having a contracts of millions of dollars in Iraq and the Iraq and Kuwait war explode, and then he had you will not believe the kind of trouble what that enterprise has faced. But somewhere other ways, it was a bigger enterprise. They got able to sustain that, but a couple of years were the worst. I mean, for them. So you have to look. You have to keep your keep gathering what is happening around you. World over, nation over, your community over, your state over, your district over, and what is happening in your competitors, and whatever, every aspect of your life, you have to be watchful, you have to keep gathering the information, analyze the information, and take the proper inferences. Why I'm telling you this background is that sometime around 1999, or say around 1999-2000, there was a change in the political scenario. The economic policy of government FDI changed totally. The world changed the economy. Say, the liberalization, the buzzword came in the picture, liberalization that came in the 91, but actually the effects of it, they started showing the effects in 95 and 96 onwards. And world over, around 97-98, it was in a fluid stage. The entire world economy was in a fluid stage, and no country or no state was in a specific position, were not able to determine the specific position of the policy matters to decide on that, how to deal or how to do with this pre-economy world. What is WTO? What is there in the WTO? What way I can protect myself? What way I can protect my manufacturers? It was in a fluid stage. And at that time, some of the decisions, all the economies in the world, and especially, I'm not so big at the time, but there's so many decisions are the happening. I can say I don't criticize on anybody on any decisions, but the happenings at that time were unfortunately not conducive to the growth or survival of engineering industries in India. Because in that particular couple of years, the recession was so strong that several big corporates, they closed down few divisions. This is the presentation what I said, how many products we have done and how we have gone to that. But this situation that we made the efforts to survive, to sustain and to continue with the regular practices. But as the situation changed, you need to change. There are some business decisions, whether you like it or not, you have to take those decisions. And then we took some decisions. We took the decisions. Believe me, these are not easy things to take these kind of decisions. But here the face to reality. To run away from the reality is a suicidal. So they have to run away from the reality. You accept the reality. See what best you can make the efforts to sustainability. If you find out, you try, you found out it's not over, it's not getting over, I need to do something, then you have to take altogether different decisions to match with the environments and keep you growing, to keep your talents properly utilized for the aspects what you had discussed earlier. So I decided the same. I took some decisions. Those years were very, very, very critical for me in my life. As we are on the Rotary platform, I can say that even I was thinking at that time to get rid of a Rotary Club, but I given a second thought and I found out that Rotary Club is the only entity where I got a fresh breath, and that is what is most needed at that time. So that was a very, very complimentary for me. to keep up my psyche and to keep a proper logical thinking. So I decided to withdraw from some of the established companies, and then to make the SWOT analysis, that what is available for me, what is my strength, do I have any capital, what is capital left with me, what are my talents available with me, and how I organize that thing, and what are the threats if I get into that. So what, and at that time, again, as I say, the environment is very changing. The energy used to be the buzzword. The energy, cost of energy everywhere in the world is going up and up every day. The world was very, very, you can say, the jagrut or the conscious about the environments. The carbon credits, the environments, the carbon footprints, those are the words world is trying itself. And then I found out, yes, I know, because I dealt with the energy. I know the basics of energy. In all my products, what I have done is the conservation of the energy. And fortunately for me, as my hobby or as my interest, I was involved in the research projects of TERI. TERI, you know, that the energy research organization. And then I got into that. So I could able to make some research. I could able to present some papers. I could get some insights out of that. And then I got involved into the energy projects with that team. And I generated a new entity altogether, and the foundry projects is at my heart, so I know it. There I make the innovations with that. Normally for the, any foundry projects layouts, you measure the things in the tons for weight or the inches and foots or the centimeters, millimeters or the meters, what should be the layout and all. I change the concepts. I put the T into that. T is the time for the process requirement. So why I got the success into this particular aspect is that I didn't consider only the three coordinates X, Y, Z, but I added T to that, T of every process to optimize the process, to have the energy conservation done into that. And then what should be the layout based for that, and what could be the sustainable in future for the development and the production and the progress of that particular enterprise. So I could able to get a little bit success into that. And the energy projects. The energy projects also, we could able to get some innovative ideas. So far, what I found out the energy projects, what the difference I identified and what I concentrated, I will tell you in the last couple of minutes, is that normally the energy auditors, which we take them as the energy men or the consultants for the energy, but they don't know about the processes. So they can measure, they will work like the pathological lab, they will give you the results, but they don't tell you how to correct with that. They will give some ideas, but they cannot execute that. And the process experts, they don't know how the energy behaves. So with the acumen, whatever I have gathered so far, I try to club it together, that energy, process and the energy, how the energy behaves, how it link it to the process optimization, and how you have the sustainable project, energy conservation in every process. Fortunately, I came across very good of my colleagues. One of them is our own Rotarian, Rahul. And then we started that. What you are looking forward is that the real-time data and all. We started doing working on that around a decade before. The real-time data, how the energy data, real-time data, then you link it to the your production throughout. You use the SCADA for that. You take the action, and we were just a step behind AI, artificial intelligence. So the message what I want to give you to you is that you have to clean up yourself with the times. Forget about that. What is the past? If you start dwelling in the past, nothing will happen. You will start digging yourself. You be in the present, think of the future. So a decade before, maybe more than that, we started thinking what is required, what you need to look at it, what is the sustainable and what is the best, and what will give you the real sustainability and the growth to your enterprise. And we thought on all these things, and then we rather not formulated, because you cannot formulate anything in entrepreneurship. What I say, the very, very popular saying is that the success is success. There is nothing like success. The wise men, like a boxer and all, they formulate the success and we the students, we make attempt to learn that and make efforts to have that success. But believe me, there is no specific formula. You have to keep on thinking. You have to keep tuning up yourself with the times. You have to look ahead, keeping your feet very strongly rooted on your ground. And you have to think of tomorrow, what you need, and you start working on that today. And that's the success. That's the way. I mean, you will go close to the success, and I'm sure you will get the success with this kind of working. Whatever the virtues, what we have said earlier, whatever the theoretical backgrounds and the thoughts, what Krishan sir and Mr. Pradeep sir has given to you, and whatever I have shared with my case study with you, if you rather think concurrently of all these aspects and draw your own plan, make your own SWOT analysis, and think of your own enterprise, I'm sure the success will follow with you. Suddenly, you start following your goal, and believe me,